And yeah, I guess he's presenting a definition of representation.
All right, thanks, Najif. Thanks to the organizer for inviting me to speak, and thanks for putting together this nice workshop. So I want to talk about some recent joint work with Najif, and this is about an attempt to put forth a formal framework for how one should think about representation learning and whether it's benefits. So let me kind of give a quick overview of what I want to do. So I want to do three things in this talk. I want to motivate and introduce this new framework that will allow us to think formally about representation learning. Then I want to kind of clarify the framework and make it a little bit more concrete in two kind of common settings, so mixture models and log linear models. And finally, I want to show you ways in which having representations can be powerful. And the focus here that I'll put is on kind of two things. So one is that they can decrease the need for the amount of labeled data that you need for some classification tasks. And the second one is that they can help you do classifications in which vanilla methods like vanilla nearest neighbors or classifiers in a raw data space will require way too much data. So before we kind of do any formal definitions, let's intuitively think what we want out of our model. And I'll preface this by saying that our approach to thinking about what the goal of representation learning should be is motivated by the variety of uses and success stories that representation learning has had. And a non-exhaustive list here will be things like unsupervised learning, where we hope that representation learning is helping us discover some structure in our data, transfer learning, which is this phenomenon that features that we learn for one task seem to be relevant and useful for other seemingly unrelated tasks, and semi-supervised learning, in which we hope that if we get some magical nice representation, it's actually going to help us do classification with a smaller number of labeled samples. And so what I'll mostly focus on is the last point here, though our our framework will be very much informed by Bayesian types of modeling considerations, so you will definitely get a dose of unsupervised learning. Okay, so intuitively, what do we want out of representations? So typically, we tend to think of a representation as a relatively high-level, succinct description of our objects, whereas the raw representation is low-level and is very detailed. So a little bit of introspection will lead us to the conclusion that this map is intuitively many to one. So when I'm going from raw data to representations, this should be many to one. And for example, let's look at the image that I have here. So I have three different pictures of a German short-haired pointer, and he's in the, a few different positions. And intuitively, we do expect these to map to the same representation, or at least to something. The representations should be very, very close to each other. Okay, and so our proposal for how you should model this is the following. In order to generate the possible raw data manifestations of some particular representation, there's going to be some probabilistic process which involves a deterministic function g, which eats up the representation as one argument, and some extra random seeds. Okay, and so now if I look at the x that I'm getting this way, this is some kind of distribution over possible raw data manifestations of some representation h. Okay. So another kind of intuitive property that we want is we want there to be some kind of utility from passing to this space of representations versus doing things directly on raw data. And a minimal thing that you could imagine is that classification actually makes sense and is easier in representation space. So at the minimum, what you would expect is that for whatever classification task you're interested in, there actually is a classifier which goes from a representation space to, let's say, distribution over labels, which gives you a low error. Also, we're going to need for our framework to make sense, we're going to need it to be Lipschitz. So what I mean by this is if I view my classifier as taking a particular representation and producing a distribution over labels, I want this to be Lipschitz with respect to some appropriate norm over the representations. So from these two intuitive considerations, a natural definition pops up. So from the first kind of intuitive consideration, we know that our x's are sort of produced as these sort of like, by applying this kind of deterministic function to our h and some random seed. So one could think of the representation as sort of inverting this map g in some sense, if you will. So that kind of motivates the definition of what we call an encoder, and this is kind of to keep in line with the deep learning nomenclature. So we'll call a function f a beta gamma valid encoder if with probability at least beta over the x's that I'm producing via my probabilistic process, I'm producing something which is close, so 1 minus gamma, I guess they are close, to the correct representation h. Okay. And in order for this to, in order for an encoder to be good, you want beta and gamma to be close to one, of course. Okay, and as a direct corollary of this definition, our second kind of intuitive consideration, which is that there is some kind of sense in doing classification in representation space, we basically get it immediately from here that if instead of plugging in the representation, we plug in the output of our encoder, we'll also get something, basically a good classifier for whatever task we're interested in.
So this notion of representation depends on the class on what you're trying to classify. For every task, classification task will have a different manifestation of your...
Potentially, yes. So this is definitely tied to a task, yes.
No.
So there should...
could have many classifiers.
We don't have a quantification of a classifier.
No. So I'm saying, like, if there is a, basically, you need to have a good classifier for this definition to be meaningful, right? If there isn't a good classifier for a task, then you're kind of like
a. No, but there's a set of classifiers for the representation space.
And the question is it for any or for just a for fixed one?
I guess it's a fixed one. Classifier, then the
for every.
No.
One for the order zero.
For every.
The definition definitely makes sense for every, right? But. Okay.
M is it, you mean average.
Yeah. Okay. So let me try to compare to some kind of related notions here. So something that's very close to this is manifold learning. So in manifold learning, you will basically assume that your points, while being high dimensional, they implicitly lie close to or on some low dimensional manifold. And sort of the problem with this approach is that typically the way you learn this manifold is that you sort of try to learn the local geometry of the manifold and then kind of recover from that the entire manifold. And this eventually boils down to some kind of epsilon net type of argument. So typically the sample complexity will scale exponentially with the dimension of the manifold. In contrast to that, in our framework, I'll give you basically simple examples where you can do with only polynomially many samples in the dimension of the manifold. I mean, of course, RH is also defined implicitly some kind of manifold. Kernel learning is also sort of a relatively related notion. So in kernel learning, what you're doing is that you don't really want to sort of, for some particular classification task, you think that there is a good kernel which lies in some family of kernels, but you sort of want to optimize over the kernels in this family. So in our particular case, some of the representations that we'll be producing effectively look like a linear map, applied to your raw data and then applying some thresholding right after. And so then this is kind of unclear whether this corresponds to any kernel. Okay. So the point I'm trying to make is that our notion is kind of different than these previous things. Okay. So finally, this is kind of clearly inspired and related to Bayesian modeling, and because I'm basically assuming that conditioned on the representation, I have some distribution over possible raw data. You could go full Bayesian, and you say that there is also some prior distribution over the H's, and then you are specifying a full kind of joint distribution over both representations and observables. But then you sort of might worry that our definition of an encoder requires you to sort of produce for an X like a single representation. Whereas if you were Bayesian, then you would basically have a posterior distribution over possible H's. But in fact, this kind of seeming friction can be easily resolved, and this is sort of a restatement of a result that appeared in a paper due to Aurora, Kohler, and Ma, that effectively, if you have a good encoder, this basically implies that for a large fraction of the excess, the posterior on H basically concentrates close to the value that you're getting from the encoder. Okay? All right, so now what I want to do is I want to basically give you kind of a self-contained example where I want to show you two things. So the first thing I want to show you is that, it's at some simple and natural setting. And I want to show you that encoders can be efficiently learned, both in terms of sample complexity and runtime. And moreover, they are useful for this sort of semi-supervised learning kind of scenario that we're interested in, meaning that if you try to do something like classification or like nearest neighbors directly in representation space, you will require, directly in observable space, you will require way too many samples. Whereas if you do it in representation space, you will require a substantially smaller number of samples. Okay, so the setting is pretty simple. It's recommendation systems, and in fact, it's probably even simpler than the recommendation sort of system setting that you're used to. So the setup is as follows. You get to see a bunch of users, and then you get to see a sort of a subset of the movies they like. So in this particular setting, there isn't sort of a numerical value of how much a user likes a movie. It's just basically he likes some subset of the movies and doesn't like the rest of them, and you get to see some subset of the ones that he or she likes. And then you could imagine that the task is something like, let's say, for some user, I ask for some particular movie, does the user like the movie or not? So we need to sort of, in order to talk about, you know, like encoders and their benefits and stuff, we need to basically, we need to impose some kind of latent structure, okay? And the easiest way to impose a latent structure would be a sort of linear structure, meaning a mixture model. So what that would mean in this case would be the following. You will basically have the following kind of latent structure on users and movies. So there are going to be a bunch of genres, and genres are subset of movies, let's say subset of N movies. And a user will be a mixture of genres. So what does that mean? If I get to see, let's say, T movies that a user likes, the way I'm picking these movies is as follows. T times, I will repeat the following procedure. I will first pick one of the genres in the mixture of the user uniformly at random, and then I'll pick one of the movies in that genre uniformly at random. And of course, you don't really have to pick them uniformly at random. You can pick them with some mixing proportions. Let's say you put them in some vector H, and you don't have to pick a movie from a given genre uniformly at random. Again, you can have some relative proportions of emitting a particular movie, given that it's from a particular genre. And so then when you put them as columns in some matrix A, you can sort of succinctly write the model as follows. Okay? And just to make sure we're all on the same page, the encoder in this case is supposed to map the movies that a particular user has liked to the latent genres H. And the semi-supervised sort of portion here would be that you get to learn the encoder first, and then you can do classification knowing these H's. Okay? So now the first portion which I promised was that these encoders can actually be learned. And so again, this is sort of, our work is kind of done in this case, at least in this linear case. So if A satisfies some relatively natural property having to do something with something called the L1 condition number, it turns out that you can learn a good encoder, which in time which runs and time in samples which runs polynomial in the number of movies. Moreover, this is true when you get very sparse data, meaning that the number of movies that you get to see per user is only logarithmic in the total number of movies. Okay? So the last bit is very important.
So in this case, is the encoder unique?
No. I mean, you have concentration around what the encoder is producing, but there's no sense of uniqueness.
I lost track of what class of classifiers you're implicitly talking about.
I haven't told you exactly yet.
No. Classifiers use genre vectors and map to something.
No, I mean, I think he's asking whether you have a particular classification task in mind. So you can think of just basically predicting whether a user likes a movie or not.
For any task using H.
Sure, but I think he's asking whether he means something concrete or just, okay.
Well, no, I guess I'm asking, are you restricting to some particular class? Are all functions acting on this vector? I mean, what sense is it representing?
So up to this point, I mean, this is just about the existence of an encoder, right? An encoder has nothing to do with a particular classification task, right? The definition is completely free of that. It's a corollary that if you have a good encoder, then you can do.
Maybe it's the other way. The classification tasks you're interested in are the ones that use H.
Yeah.
Or any classification that uses H.
Sorry, again, here, I mean, I'm coming back to what I said. H is unique, right? I mean, this lower bound that you have, if I give you AH, you know H, right?
No, but you were asking whether or not, in some sense, there is a unique way to reconstruct it or something, right? You're trying to get something close to the correct H, right? You definitely have posterior concentration, right? I mean, there is some concentration. There is, there's going to be some posterior, right? It does concentrate around some H.
In terms of the noise that you see, but in the model, in the structural model, if I saw, like, if I repeated this probability.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
Andre, finish one.
Go.
Almost done. All right, so finally, what we want to say is that we do get some kind of we get some power from these representations, and so now the way we quantify that is as follows: by looking at two different phenomena. So the first phenomena is nearest neighbors. So what we can say is the following: if the number of movies you get to observe per user is small, let's say less than square root m or something, then the nearest neighbors actually will not reflect the latent genres. And I don't have time to make this completely formal, but basically, if you look at the nearest neighbors, they will sort of not have any reasonable overlap with the genre-wise. Conversely, if you sort of, but on the other hand, you can learn the encoder when you have even just logarithmic number observations. So this is sort of telling you that the encoder is buying you something. Conversely, you know, there's some good news that if the number observation is large, then actually, you know, nearest neighbors will in fact work. And similarly, we can do we can sort of exhibit a similar kind of separation between what you can do with when you know an encoder and you don't, for sort of just the regular classification setting where you're getting a bunch of samples along with labels, and the labels are just like, you know, look as a sign of basically of inner product of some weight vector and the plus minus version of the latent vector. Right, and basically, we sort of can exhibit similar results for log linear models, which have something to do with word embeddings and restricted Boltzmann machines. But let me skip that and sort of conclude. It's out of time.
A minute for questions, and Bo, you can come.
Questions.